Good morning, students. So today we are starting our new chapter, and this chapter is from geography. The name of the chapter is Earth Movements and Major Landforms. So I am going to explain you this chapter. See, our Earth has not always looked the same. About 250 million years ago, all continents were clustered together as a supercontinent called Pangaea, which is actually a Greek term meaning all earth. It was set in a huge ocean called the Panthalassa. The theory of Pangaea was first proposed by Alfred Wegener, a German meteorologist, in AD 1915. The seven continents which exist now have come into their present shape over a millions of years. Now the next topic is lithospheric plates. The crust of the earth is broken into a number of large and small plates known as lithospheric plates. There are seven major lithospheric plates which move extremely slowly. These seven plates are the African plates, the Indo-Australian plate, the Eurasian plate, the Pacific plates, the North American plates, the South American plates, and the Antarctic plate. Now, plate movements. The lithospheric plates are constantly in motion. The movement occurs due to the heat generated by the molten magma. So, this molten magma, it is inside the earth which moves in a circulatory manner. These molten rocks expand, rise, and push the plates away from each other. When they cool down, they sink and bring the plates towards each other. This process is known as plate tectonics. There are three types of plate movements. And what are these movements? Number one, convergent plate movement. It occurs when due to forces of compression, two plates move toward each other and they collide. Then these plates, convergent plates, they occur. Next is divergent. Divergent plates. It occurs when due to forces of tension, two plates move away from each other. Next, transform plate. It occurs when two plates horizontally slide past each other. So these are the three lithospheric plates. Now, earth movements. The movement of the earth are divided on the basis of the forces that cause them. The forces that act inside the earth are called endogenic or internal forces. These are leading to earthquakes, volcanoes eruptions, and landslides. These forces that work on the surface of the earth are called exogenic or external forces. Rivers, glaciers, wind and sea waves. These all are external forces. They act slowly and result in the erosional depositional activities. Next topic of your chapter is volcanoes. A volcano, what is a volcano? It is an opening in the earth crust through which molten magma or lava erupts suddenly. This lava accumulates around the vent and forms a conical hill or a mountain with a funnel shaped depression opening at the top, which is known as the crater. As eruption takes place, the erupted material accumulates around the crater and forms a conical hill, and this conical hill is known as volcanic cone. We call it volcanic cone. These eruptions can either be explosive or quiet. Depending upon the frequency of eruption, the volcanoes can be classified into three types. So, three types of volcanoes are active volcanoes, dormant volcanoes, and extinct volcanoes. So, number one is active volcanoes. These have erupted frequently in the recent past and have possibility of further eruption at any time. For example, Mauna Loa in Hawaii and Stromboli and Mount Etna in Italy. Next is dormant volcano. Dormant volcano means which have not erupted for a long time, but they may erupt at any time. For example, Mount Fujiyama in Japan and Mount Vesuvius in Italy. Third one is extinct volcano. As the name is extinct, you can see that these volcanoes, they have not erupted for several thousands of years, and there is no possibility of eruption in future. They are also called dead volcanoes. Mount Kilimanjaro and Mount Kenya in Africa are the examples of extinct volcanoes. Most of the active volcanoes of the world, they are located in a circular belt around the Pacific Ocean known as the Pacific Ring of Fire. Some are found in the Mediterranean Sea and the Caspian Sea, known as the Mid-World Mountain Belt. Next topic of the chapter is earthquakes. Sudden vibrations that are caused by the movement of lithospheric plates are called earthquakes. Many times you have noticed the earthquakes. So these are the sudden vibrations that are sudden movement in the earth. So this happens in the lithospheric plates, and these are known as earthquakes. These vibrations, they are also called seismic waves, which travel over a long area. The point where the earthquake originates inside the earth's crust, it is called the focus. While the point on the earth's surface just above the focus is called the epicenter. Earthquake vibrations spread out in all directions from the focus. The scale of damage caused by an earthquake depends on the intensity of the earthquake, nature of the region, or topography. So, the damage can be more or less dependent on many factors. The maximum damage is always caused near the epicenter. The epicenter, we find the maximum damage. Earthquake tremors are recorded by an instrument called the seismograph, and their magnitude is or intensity, it is measured on the Richter scale. It is measured on a scale of 0 to 9. Earthquake of magnitude 7 and above are very destructive and cause heavy damage to life and property. Most of the world's earthquakes occur in the belts of young fold mountains, because here the earth's crust is weak and volcanic eruptions take place frequently. Now, measures to minimize the risk of earthquakes. So, number one, in high risk areas, construct earthquake resistant buildings and strengthen the existing ones. Number two, when an earthquake strikes, if interior movement under doorways or heavy furniture, and stay away from windows and mirrors. If outdoors, move away from the buildings and trees and electric poles. So these precautions you have to take when you are indoors and outdoors. Number three, mock drills should be conducted in educational institutes and residential complexes to spread earthquake preparedness. Gradation. The forces of nature act upon the major landforms, continuously modifying them so that the differences in their heights are reduced. The earth's surface is thus gradually leveled. The leveling of the earth's surface by natural processes is called gradation. Both internal and external forces bring about gradation. The external forces such as running water, moving ice, wind and sea waves, they are collectively called agents of gradation. Gradation involves both degradation and aggradation. The process of degradation or denudation is the wearing down of the highlands, while the process of aggradation is the deposition of the broken rock fragments in low-lying areas. Degradation, it can be of two types, weathering and erosion. The process of breaking down or decomposition of rocks in their place of origin is called weathering. The process of wearing down of rocks by the agents of gradation and transportation of the eroded materials to be deposited elsewhere is called erosion. Now, let us learn about the various landforms that are produced by the agents of gradation. See, I have just discussed about the degradation and aggradation. So, the meaning of degradation is the wearing down of the land surface, and the meaning of aggradation is the deposition of eroded materials on a certain place to form a new landform. Now, we will discuss about the landforms that are made by the rivers. Rivers, as you know, they are the most important agents of gradation. The valley formed by a river is narrow and shaped like the letter V. Hence, it is called V-shaped valley. When a river erodes vertically through hard rocks, the valley formed is very deep and narrow. Such a valley is called a gorge. And since it is shaped like the letter I, it is also called an I-shaped valley. A wider steep wall and usually flat bottomed valley is called a canyon. When a river flows down a steep valley side or erodes the underlying soft rocks faster than the hard rocks lying above, there is an abrupt drop in its slope and it plunges down from a great height, forming a waterfall. When a river enters the plain, it flows very slowly and forming broad sweeping curves or loops called meanders. Due to continuous erosion and deposition, the meander becomes wider and the ends of the loop comes closer. Eventually, the meander gets separated from the river, forming a cut-off lake, which is also called an Oxbow Lake. You can see the picture of the Oxbow Lake formation. Sometimes the river overflows its banks, flooding the surrounding area. Fine silt called alluvium is deposited on the banks of the river, forming a fertile flood plain. The raised river banks are called natural levees. As the river moves towards the sea, it becomes very slow and splits into several small channels. And these small channels, they are known as distributaries. All the sediments carried by the river and its channels are deposited at the mouths. The triangular shaped region near the mouth of the river with a network of distributaries is called a delta. The place where we found it is at the mouth of the river and it is triangular in shape, that is known as, the network of distributaries is known as delta. And the famous delta, all of you know, it is the Ganga Brahmaputra delta, and it is the biggest delta in the world. Now these, we have read about the landforms which are made by the rivers. Now the landforms that are made by glaciers. Glaciers are slow moving masses of snow and ice. They are also known as the rivers of ice. They are found in the polar snowfields and in the ice-capped mountains. Like rivers, glaciers also break and carry away rock materials. The valley formed by a glacier has steep sides and a flat bottom. It resembles the letter U. Such a valley is called a U-shaped valley. Glaciers also carve out shallow armchair shaped basins in the mountains, and these basins are called corries. When the ice melts, these get filled up with water, forming the lakes. When a glacier descends a valley, it melts because of the warmer climate. Its load consisting of clay, sand, gravel and boulders cannot be carried any longer and is eventually dropped. So these deposits are called moraines. Now these are the landforms that are made by glaciers: U-shaped valley, quarries and moraines. Now the landforms that are made by wind. Wind action is also most prominent. It is most prominent in deserts, as there is hardly any vegetation to check the velocity of wind. When strong winds laden with coarse sand particles strike the surface of a rock mass, it gets eroded. The base of the rock is eroded more than the top. Eventually, the rock resembles a mushroom with a narrow base and a wide top. Such rocks are called mushroom rocks or rock pedestals. When the velocity of the wind decreases or there is some obstacle in its path, all the material carried by the wind is deposited. The most important feature formed as a result of this deposition is the sand dune. You have seen sand dunes in the deserts. So these are the features that are formed due to the deposition of the sand. A sand dune, it is a low hill of sand. Winds carry the fine sand particles far away, much beyond the deserts, and deposit them in humid regions. This deposit is yellowish gray in color and form a soil called loess. extensive loess deposits are found in North China. So all these are the landforms that are made by the wind. Now the landforms which are made by waves. Sea waves, they are also the most important agents of erosion that modify coastal landforms. In places where the coast is rocky with a steep slope and almost vertical wall of rock is formed by the erosive action of sea waves, and the landform that is formed there is known as sea cliff. Gradually the cliff is worn away and recedes inland, leaving behind a flat surface called a wave cut platform. Sometimes if the rock at the base of cliff is weak, the action of waves scoops out holes which become enlarged to form caves. Gradually these caves get bigger and only the roofs remain, forming arches. As erosion continues, the roofs collapse, leaving only the walls, which are called stacks. Stacks get further eroded to form stumps. The eroded materials are deposited by the waves along the coast, and these deposits accumulate and form a beach. It is essentially made up of sand, gravel, and pebbles brought by the waves. So all of you know about, you have seen the beaches also, and you must be knowing many beaches of India. Many beaches you have seen in Goa, even in Mumbai. Okay, so you all know about the beaches. So beaches are formed due to the waves only. So in this way we have finished our chapter, and you will get the PDF of this chapter. And be ready with your queries in your query session. Thank you.